الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم بارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dearest brothers and sisters in Islam, is there any one of you at all in the audience, any one of you listening to me at all in the audience that has ever been chronically hungry? Listen to what I'm saying. Chronic hunger. Do you know what that means? It means every single day you've actually been hungry. Not just Ramadan, because Ramadan is part of our worship. We all get hungry in Ramadan. But any other time, every single day that you've gone without breakfast and lunch, perhaps dinner as well, and you only had one morsel of food to eat. Anyone amongst you here at all? Anyone with a hand? I can't see a single hand. But the World Bank, they published a report that in 2011, 1 billion people, 1 billion people are chronically hungry. Every day they go to sleep without lunch, without breakfast, perhaps only dinner. Perhaps only a little bit of food to eat. And that dinner also is not a proper food. 1 billion people, 1 billion people, brothers and sisters in Islam. One in six people on this earth are going to sleep without food. Now, my brothers and sisters in Islam, is there anyone in the audience over here who's lost their father and their mother when they were a little baby, a little child, lost their father and mother and had no one to look after them? No one at all to look after them. Anyone in the audience? Anyone at all? No one. I can't see any hands. UNICEF, part of the world, part of the UN, they published a report that in 2011, in this year that we are in, no less than 220 million orphans exist. 220 million orphans now in this year, up from 140 million a few years ago. The question I have for you, my brothers and sisters in Islam, is this: what have you done to prove your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? What have you done to prove your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? To prove your humanity and your association with other human beings? Have you at the very least spread Islam? Have you at the very least fed a poor person? Have you at the very least rubbed your hands on the hair of an orphan? My brothers and sisters in Islam, how much does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala do for us? He created us. He gave us life. He gave us good health. He gave us wealth. He gave us children. He gave us wives and spouses. He gave us beautiful homes to live in. He promises for us an eternal paradise. He will elevate our status and let us look at His face on the Day of Judgment. How does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala love us so much? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Wallahi, indeed Allah loves us and loves people far more than a mother who has lost her child when she finds her child back." Imagine when a mother who's lost her child finds the child for the first time, how much does she love the child, subhanallah. It is for this reason why Sufyan al-Thawri, rahimahullah, used to say, "Wallahi, I would rather have Allah as my judge on the Day of Judgment rather than my own parents." Why? Because I know Allah loves me more than my own parents. Allahu Akbar. My brothers and my sisters in Islam, how much does Allah Azza wa Jal love us is shown by the fact that even when we disobey Him, He still feeds us, He still clothes us, He still lets us breathe. But Allah, He still provides for us and nourishes us and sustains us. Even whilst we're disobeying Him, but Allah, even when we're committing that sin, Allah is still letting us breathe. Allah is still letting us eat our food. Ya Salam. How great and how noble and how merciful is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Indeed, it is because of this that one of His most beautiful names Allah azza wa jalla has revealed to us, told us about from the 99 names that we should memorize to go to Jannah. One of the names is Al-Wadud. Do you know what Al-Wadud means? He is the loving God. Al-Wadud, the one who loves, the one who has mercy with his creation, the one who loves to love his creation, the one who loves his creation so much so that the love that he has sent on this earth is only one part of 99 parts that he has prepared for the believers in the day of judgment. So my brothers and my sisters in Islam, what have you done to prove to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you love him? What is it that you have done to prove to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you love him? What actions can you identify with that you have done to prove to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala when he asks you on the day of judgment, Ya Abdi, O my slave, how have you proven that you love me so that I may love you back on this day? My slave, what have you done to prove that you love me? My brothers and my sisters in Islam, by Allah, there is not a single person, the one who is speaking and the one being spoken to, except that he will find a level of hypocrisy in his heart in this question, by Allah. Wallahi, we say we love Allah, but we are not true in our love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We say we love Allah, but by Allah, our actions are lacking. There are a number of reasons why we are so. No one amongst us does not want to love Allah. Every single Muslim in this audience and out there, the billions of Muslimin, everyone will say, I love Allah or I want to love Allah. However, certain things prevent them from proving their love for Allah Azza wa Jal. The first thing that prevents them is this negativity. I can't be that great. I can't prove my love to Allah. I've done too much sins. I'm not someone special. I don't have Islamic knowledge. I only know so little. I'm not from a great family. I'm not a great speaker. How can I truly do so many things? How can I prove my actions? How can I increase my actions in order to prove my love to Allah Azza wa Jal? I'm no one special. But by Allah, you are special. You are special. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, when a slave stands in his salah and he says, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, Allah answers the slave back and says, my slave has praised me. So every time you speak to Allah, Allah speaks to you back. You are not a person in 6 billion. You are the person in 6 billion at that moment. Because Allah, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, despite looking after the affairs of creation, has time for you. Oh my brothers and my sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pays attention to you. He created you and you're more valuable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the Kaaba. Wallahi, the scholars of Islam say, the tears of a believer are more precious than the Kaaba. Hakada qala Shawkani. Ash-Shawkani rahimahullah says, the tears of a believer are more precious to Allah azza wa jal than indeed the Kaaba itself. Have you not heard, Shawkani says, the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that indeed 7 people will be given shade on the day of judgment. And one of those people to be given shade on the day of judgment will be a man who remembers Allah, and out of fear and love for Allah, his eyes tear, wallahi. And so he says, wallahi, the tears are more beloved to Allah than the Kaaba by Allah. So my beloved brothers and sisters in Islam, do not be of those people who are negative about your love for Allah Azza wa Jal. Be of those people who are positive about it. Every single time you feel negative, every single time you feel you can't prove your love to Allah Azza wa Jal, every single time you think of doing something to show Allah Azza wa Jal, Ya Rab, you are more important to me than the whole of this dunya, Ya Allah. Every single time you feel like this, remember by Allah, the Prophet was a very positive person. Be very positive about yourself. Be very positive that you can make a change. Be very positive that you will have an effect in changing the ummah. Every single time, the believers in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ were being negative, the Prophet was positive. Every single time. When Yusuf ﷺ was in the bottom of the well, in his greatest moment of despair, there came upon him an angel by the name of Jibreel, who told him that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him the following thing, لَتُنَبِّئَنَّهُمْ بِأَمْرِهِمْ هَذَا وَهُمْ لَا يَشْعُرُونَ. Verily, O Yusuf, a day will come when you will tell them about what they have done, and by Allah, they will not even know that it is you telling them. And this is the positivity of Islam. When the mother of Musa alayhi salatu wasalam was despairing, what did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tell her? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told her, throw Musa into the river. Indeed, my enemy will grab him. And then by Allah, out of Allah's mercy, in some way or the other, Allah will return Musa back to his mother so that she does not despair. Positivity in the eyes of negativity. When the people stood there and said, we are going to throw this little boy by the name of Ibrahim into this huge fire. What did Ibrahim say? Hasbunallahu ni'mal wakeel. Ibn Abbas said, this was said by three people. The first person who said it was Ibrahim alayhi salatu wasalam. When the people all gathered together, built a huge fire to throw Ibrahim in there. What did he say? Positivity in the eyes of tremendous negativity. Hasbunallahu ni'mal wakeel. Allah is our protector, and enough is He a protector over us. My brothers and sisters in Islam, when Ibrahim wanted to kill his son, what did his son say in the eyes of negativity? His son said what? He said, Ya Abati, if'al ma tu'mar, satajiduni, insha'allahu minas sabirin. Oh my father, do as you've been commanded. Indeed you will find me, insha'Allah, by Allah's will, from the patient ones. In the eyes of negativity, by Allah, remember how the Prophet was. When Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu was moving in front and moving in the back at the time of Hijrah, when he was in the cave, when he was despairing, when the Quraysh came, what did the Prophet say? In the eyes of negativity, the Prophet said, La tahzan inna allaha ma'ana. Do not despair, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with us. My brothers and my sisters in Islam, if Allah didn't want good for you, why did He give you the opportunity to listen to this talk? If Allah didn't want good for you, why did Allah give you the opportunity to come today? The wealth by which you paid for your petrol, by the car that you came here, the time and the health and the goodly opportunity to come here and listen to the talks and the knowledge that was given by the scholars over here. Why, my brothers and sisters in Islam, if Allah doesn't like you and doesn't want good for you, why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give you the opportunity to give in His cause? By Allah, Allah loves you all. And by Allah, Allah wants khair for you. And by Allah, Allah wants to see you in Jannah. The question is, do you want to see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Jannah? Indeed, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said in the authentic hadith, Man ahabba liqa'a Allah, ahabba Allahu liqa'ah. وَمَنْ كَرِهَ لِقَاءَ اللَّهِ كَرِهَ اللَّهُ لِقَاءَهُ. Whoever loves to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet him. And whoever hates to meet Allah, Allah hates to meet him. Ask yourself, are you from those people? My brothers and my sisters in Islam, one day the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam stood up in the depths of the night. It is authentically reported in Al-Bukhari that he raised his hands up to the heavens. And he said, Oh Allah, my ummah. Ya Allah, my ummah. Ya Allah, my ummah. He couldn't say more than that. He couldn't finish his sentences because he was so emotional. Until the night passed and the last third of the night came. Until Fajr time came. And at that point, Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam came down and said, Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Allah has sent me. And said, Ya Muhammad, your Lord will not disappoint you regarding your ummah. Your Lord will not disappoint you regarding your ummah. The question is, brothers and sisters in Islam, are we going to disappoint our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Are we going to disappoint our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Allah has promised our Prophet, He will not disappoint him regarding our ummah. The question is us. Are we going to otherwise not fulfill the promise of Allah and be a disappointment for our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Be you of those people who fulfill His vision. Be you of those people who fulfill your love for Allah Azza wa Jal by pursuing the vision of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on this earth. I ask you, my brothers and sisters in Islam, if you're feeling negative because you're constantly criticizing this work that you do, remember what Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said. He said, Wallahi, Allah loved Abu Bakr and Umar so much that He created a nation of millions of people known as the Shia, who would curse Abu Bakr day and night, so that by Allah, Abu Bakr can take their good deeds and they can take the bad deeds of Abu Bakr and Umar. Allahu Akbar. This is the positivity in the eyes of negativity. This is why a Shafi'i rahimullah used to say, measly is the situation of the person who is not criticized. So do not be afraid of criticism. Do not be afraid of those people who talk too much. Get on and get doing your good deeds. Do not worry about people who criticize and tell you otherwise. For those people who are going through great difficulty in their life, remember the story of Al-Mutanabbi, a great poet in Arabia. He used to say, whenever I used to have disease, and had difficulty in my body, I used to write the best of poetry, the most emotional poetry. And indeed, I would wait for those times of difficulty because my poetry would be the best. So if you're of those people who are afflicted by difficulty, remember the story of Al-Mutanabbi. For those people who are significantly trying to do da'wah to your families, people come to me and say, I've been trying to change my family, I've been trying to change them, telling my mom that she to pray, my dad to pray. What message do I have for you? I have the message of the great scholar Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Abdullah ibn Mubarak used to have a Jewish neighbor and he used to give him da'wah for 20 years until a day came when the Khalifa came to Abdullah ibn Mubarak and came to the neighbor of Abdullah ibn Mubarak, the Jewish neighbor, and said, I have to demolish your house because we have to build a road on this path. And what did the Jewish neighbor say? He said, okay, I will sell you my house for 2,000 dinars, 2,000 gold coins. So the Khalifa said, why 2,000 when the house is only 1,000 gold dinars? He said, 1,000 gold dinars for the house and 1,000 for being the neighbor of Abdullah ibn Mubarak. Then he went to Abdullah ibn Mubarak and accepted Islam. My brothers and my sisters in Islam, those who are despairing that your parents don't listen to you, your wife doesn't pray, your husband doesn't listen, your uncle, aunties, your brothers and sisters not listening to you, be patient by Allah. Just like Abdullah ibn Mubarak was. Because when they lose you by Allah, they will surely understand the value that you have come to them. For those people who have lost hope, think that they cannot do any good at all, remember the story of Al-Saraqsi rahimahullah. Imam Al-Saraqsi, the great scholar of the Hanafi Madhab, was imprisoned in the well for 10 years. But by Allah, this did not stop him. He used to recite at the bottom of the well. He used to recite his book until his students would come at the top of the well and write down everything he used to say until they filled up a volume of 27 volumes of a book by the name of Al-Mabsut. 27 volumes from what Al-Saraqsi would say from the bottom of the well. Never despair. You can always prove your love to Allah Azza wa Jal wherever you are in whatever situation you are. For those people who are being harmed, who are being hurt by your families and by your situation now, but Allah, remember the situation, Imam Ahmed rahimahullah, and remember that he was also harmed and hurt for years and years. He was lashed until his arms were out of his sockets, yet he never gave up being upon the truth. For those people who are looking at the situation, the Muslimin around us, and say there is no hope for this ummah, this ummah is destroyed, there is no hope for it. Those who look at the situation of Islam and Muslims and the countries of Islam and Muslims being eaten up by other people, but Allah, never despair. Let me tell you what Ibn Kathir says in his Bidawa al-Nihaya, and I recite to you the following. He says, a million crusaders entered into Bayt al-Maqdis and they did with it what animals do in the forest, and they perpetrated that which even the shaitans do not do. In 1 week, they killed 60,000 people. From them, the scholars, the worshippers, the imams of masajid, and the ascetics. They put up the cross over Bayt al-Maqdis. They brought into Bayt al-Maqdis the pigs and replaced the adhan with the callings of disbelief and shirk. And people cried and they cried and they cried, and they thought that Bayt al-Maqdis would never ever return to the control of Islam and Muslims, and that there will never be an end to this trial and tribulation of the people of Islam. So the disgrace upon the believers continued until Allah raised from this ummah a hero who planted the love for the blood of struggling in the path of Allah flow through the veins, and he planted the spirit of struggle and valor in the souls, and he destroyed the pessimism that had unsheathed the hearts. So there stood the man by the name of Salahuddin, and he called out from A'maq and Jadana. He said, oh woe to Islam. On that cry, the heroes from the army of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam stood up until they met the crusaders, and they killed 30,000 of them, and they opened up Al-Quds and they purified the sacred lands from the evil ones. Their victory continued until the crusaders had no option but to pay the jizya from a lowly hand, after the crusaders had been the commanders in authority in power for 91 years. My brothers and my sisters in Islam, those who are despairing about the situation of the ummah, by Allah, it could be we are on that 90th year. We could be on the 90th year, the year before Allah gives this ummah victory. You know what? It could be Allah laughing at this ummah because His mercy is just about to come. Never despair of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Never despair and prove your love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be positive, go out there, do every work of good deeds that you can, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make your deeds acceptable to Him. For those who think that they don't have the skills and the knowledge and the ability, by Allah, I will tell you, every single person that has made an effect in this dunya was not a really great man before they became great. They were not particularly talented, not particularly educated, not particularly eloquent. They didn't need the permission of everybody. They didn't have the help of everyone as well. But Allah, they had one thing and one thing only, and that was a deep burning desire to achieve something. Gandhi, when he thought that he was going to throw the people out of India, when was that time? It was the most unique of times when he was being thrown out of the carriage, the first class carriage in South Africa. That is the moment as his cheeks hit the ground, as he was being thrown out of the train. He said, I made up my mind at that point that I'm going to free India from the British. Ya Salam. This is the nature of visionaries. This is the nature of people who want to do good, that by Allah their visions are completely illogical sometimes, completely incomprehensible, completely imbecilic sometimes to people, and sometimes quite silly. But by Allah, this is the nature of visions. This is the power of vision. This is the power of passion, my brothers and sisters in Islam. It's completely illogical. But by Allah, by some heavenly logic, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it possible. So my brothers and my sisters in Islam, as we come to a close for this beautiful conference, and by Allah, it was made beautiful by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's barakah and your presence. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala let every single person who leave this conference go away with a tremendous desire in his heart to prove his love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Let this be the call that you all have. Let this be the promise that you all make as you walk out of this conference. So my brothers and my sisters in Islam, make an oath and a promise to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you're going to do something to prove your love to Allah azza wa jal. Right? You're going to prove your love to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And by Allah, be of those people who fulfill your promise. And I remind you all, lastly, of the ayah and the verse in the Quran, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says about the people and the men who have promised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Verily, from the believers are those who have fulfilled what they have promised Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Minhum man qada nahbahu. From them are those people who have already passed away. Wa minhum man yantadhir. And from them are those people that are still waiting to fulfill their promise. وَمَا بَدَّلُوا تَبْدِيلًا. They have not changed by Allah in their promise. The scholars of tafsir say, this verse was revealed regarding a sahabi by the name of Anas bin Nadhr. Anas bin Nadhr radiallahu anhu was a sahabi who accepted Islam just right after Badr, just before Uhud. And by Allah, when he accepted Islam after Badr but before Uhud, he felt sad. He felt sad. Why did he feel sad? Because he had missed the greatest of battles, the Battle of Badr. So he made a promise to Allah, raising his hands to the heavens, said, Ya Rabbi, if you give me another chance, I will prove to you my promise to you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a chance and gave him the Battle of Badr. And by Allah, he fought in the Battle of Uhud, I'm sorry. And he fought in the Battle of Uhud until they said that he was wounded 36 times, all in the front, and they could not recognize him except by the tip of his fingers that his sister would recognize him for. Why? Because by Allah, he proved his promise to Allah that if Allah gives him another battle, he will truly prove to Allah how much valor he has, how much love he has for this deen, how much he wants to defend this deen. And by Allah, this is the verse that was revealed for him. Verily, from believers are those who are truthful to the covenant from Allah. From them are those that have passed away. And from them are those that still await their death. By Allah, they have not changed in their promise to Allah. Ask yourself this question. Are you going to change in your promise to Allah Azza wa Jal? Or are you going to be of the believers that are from the men and the women that are true believers that hold on to your promise and bi idhnillah make a true change in this ummah? Jazakumullah khair, my brothers in Islam, for attending this conference. I hope that bi idhnillah you all benefited. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen.